Sleep and Sleep Disorders, Part 1. Characteristics and the Study of Sleep.
Sen jest zjawiskiem niezwykle powszechnym.
Sleeping is an incredibly common event. It's known that we sleep away a third of our lives. In other words, each of us sleeps around 20 to 30 years. At the same time, sleep is a price we must pay for such a highly developed central nervous system. Sleep in the form we will be talking about is characteristic for mammals and birds. Organisms that have a developed central nervous system must sleep in order to function normally. Our question concerns the role sleep plays. So it's worth pointing out that, at the start, that sleep plays a major role in regenerating the organism. We sleep so that we may function normally during the day, to rest, but not only. It's only during sleep that an organism can rest, regenerate itself, mature, and record memories. Actually, it's thanks to the fact that we sleep that we're able to develop, mature, and learn. Our mind can learn to record its memories only during selected fragments of sleep. To any doubting Thomas, who thinks that sleep is time wasted and lost, it's worth remembering what sleep is absolutely necessary. Without normal sleep, we cannot function. It is an extremely common phenomenon. It's astonishing that medicine pays so little attention to it. The ancient Greeks studied the physiology of sleep and the meaning of sleep in diagnosing illnesses. But for hundreds of years after that, no one was interested in the subject. There was only one way to explain this, and that is, as did the ancient Greeks, it was generally thought that sleep is a passive phenomenon. In other words, if a person closes his eyes, turns off the light, lays down, plugs his ears, then the brain or the soul, depending on where one saw the essence of our humanity, went to sleep. It turns out that this view is false. Studies have been done for approximately 100 years, mostly in experimental physiology, and the last 30 in clinical medicine, which have clearly shown that sleep is an active event. We now know that in order to sleep, certain structures of the brain must be activated. Sleep is an activity is different from the activity of the waking state. It is a very interesting and complicated phenomenon. Perhaps that is why it has become rapid development in medicine, because we all know that sleep is a biological need, like hunger, sex, and thirst. When we're hungry, we must eat. When we're tired, we must sleep, but not only. Sleep is also a behavior, thus a state we can learn or unlearn. This is a very essential point. Everyone who has done shift work, or for professional or social reasons, has had to disrupt their sleep, knows that if we make up our minds, we can avoid sleeping. New Year's Eve is an example of total deprivation around the world, and nothing special happens. However, if we were to regularly upset our sleep, by shift work, for example, we would develop serious disorders connected with sleep. It's worth remembering, though it may sound paradoxical at first, but just as we must learn to sleep well, then later, as a result of an inappropriate lifestyle, we must unlearn how to sleep well. Another essential element that I've already mentioned is that sleep occurs in phases. It is a rhythmic, resting activities of the brain that repeats every 24 hours. We now know that sleep, or rather several types of sleep, has its specific centers in the brain. In order to fall asleep, have deep sleep, or paradoxical sleep, specific brain structures must activate. Over 2 years ago, research was done in vitro, analyzing the activity of neurons that generate sleep. Sleep takes up a third of our lives. I can only reiterate that the one-third is necessary, if the other two-thirds are to be worthwhile. Such studies have been done many times on various groups, soldiers, students, and patients. We know that a person with not enough sleep has such low productivity during the day that life during the day becomes practically valueless. We have two different types of sleep, REM and non-REM. The term REM means rapid eye movement and is also known as paradoxical sleep, because while the body is asleep, the brain begins to work very actively.
Stąd ten paradoks. No i
non-REM sleep can be considered to be calm, deep, and regenerative. It is that phase of sleep during which our body regenerates itself. In other words, rests physically, rebuilding its exhausted stores of energy, rebuilding the sensitivity of receptors, rebuilding a number of neurotransmitters in the brain. It's the time when the body patches all those holes or refills all those containers that were emptied during the waking hours. From the point of view of the physiology of the brain, it is a type of sleep when the brain is in a deep state of sleep. Research shows that the core of our brain is asleep and inactive. The body is also clearly asleep. Our heart rate is lowered. Our breathing rate also falls. Generally speaking, our bodies operate, we sleep, at a reduced capacity. On the other hand, REM sleep, paradoxical sleep, is that state wherein the body is asleep. Normally we sleep for 8 hours. However, the brain begins to be very active. This is that part of sleep where memories are recorded. It is the one period in our life when our body is able to record memories. We can even say, that's when we really learn. It's an interesting phenomenon from a psychological or psychophysiological point of view. Since we learn in our sleep, do we really not have any conscious influence on the way we learn? It's true, we don't. Of course, the brain records that information in sleep, which it collects during waking hours. But which of the millions of bits of information it decides to remember goes on in our unconscious? Of course, there's a certain control mechanism. Evolution has shaped us so that the criterion for whether or not we learn or remember something is that it be necessary in order for us to survive.
Te informacje, czy utrwala te zachowania, które są nam potrzebne po to, żeby przetrwać. To jest przy okazji już kamyk do ogródka.
This also hints at the reasons for various mental disorders. For what was necessary to survive 100, 200, or 1,000 years ago, and what is necessary now, no one really knows. But it's known that thanks to this mechanism, remembering happens completely unconsciously. One other very interesting thing worth mentioning, connected with REM sleep, since we have states in which the brain is very active, yet the body must remain asleep, control of information must be loosened in order for the situation to be maintained. If the body were to listen to the brain, as it does during waking activity, then the person would have to run after this active brain. But he doesn't run. He doesn't wake up. All we have are dreams and rapid eye movements. And that's what really does happen at the lower level of the brain's core, where the flow of information is blocked. In other words, during REM sleep, the brain stops controlling the rest of the body. That's what really happens. Our muscles are completely flaccid. Thus, if someone wakes up suddenly and can't move his arms or legs, we call it sleep paralysis. During this time, there may be disorders of internal regulators. The rhythm of the heart may fluctuate. There may be cessations of breathing. And a person may even become cold-blooded with the thermal regulatory system turned off. A person during REM sleep doesn't react with goosebumps to warm up or sweating to cool off. Of course, these are brief periods that do not present any danger. But in some situations, for example, in patients with arrhythmia, the heart may stop beating during sleep. This is the reason most deaths in cardiology ward occur near morning, when REM sleep dominates. Perhaps a few words now about the history associated with physiology or actually clinical medicine. Let's look at how sleep is studied. It is a method of research of diagnosis that is nearly 50 years old, though still not well known in the medical community. When I tell people I study sleep, people look at me as if I were someone quite exotic. Even here, in writing The Medicine of Sleep, I had to add diagnosis and treatment of sleep disorders, because most people associate sleep medicine with medicine that is not academic. However, sleep research as a diagnostic research method is nearly 50 years old. It is the all-night registration of the bioelectrical activity of the brain, and EEG, eye movements, and EOG, as well as muscle tension. Recording these three processes allows us to absolutely, objectively evaluate a person's sleep. We now know not only if a person is asleep or not, but also how he sleeps. This allows for both qualitative and quantitative analyses. I have taken the liberty of citing four works that, in my opinion, represent milestones on the road to uncovering the secrets of sleep. They include the works of Hans Berger from the 1920s, a German psychiatrist from Jena who recorded the first human electroencephalogram, claiming that by attaching metal strips to the surface of the head, one could record the bioelectrical activity of the brain. Less than 10 years later, two Americans, Harvey and Hobart, decided to apply the new discovery, called EEG, to studying the sleeping brain. They described the different phases of sleep by describing the activity of the brain during sleep. This research was abandoned during the Second World War. The fundamental work was done in the 1950s when Asarinsky, Kleitman, and Dement discovered REM sleep. This was a very mysterious phenomenon. When the electrodes were attached in different places, below the eyes, on muscles, the drop in brain activity could be seen as brain biorhythm slowed. Suddenly, 90 minutes after falling asleep, the subject started to move his eyes, and his EEG changed back to a waking pattern. That was the discovery of REM sleep. Even the name of the work reflected it. Regularly occurring periods of eye motility and concomitant phenomena during sleep. These concomitant phenomena were dreams. They woke the patient suddenly when they saw his eyes moving and that he was actively working during sleep, because they wanted to know what was going on with him. It turned out that he woke and began to tell them what he'd been dreaming about. For psychologists, psychiatrists, psychoanalysts, it was an uncommonly mysterious discovery, as they suddenly found the biological substrate of dreams. We must remember that in the 1950s, the rapid growth of psychoanalysis was experienced particularly in the United States. It was the peak of Freudism and the importance of analysis and understanding various phenomena, both psychological and physical. The fact that we could now see a patient's dreams printed on paper was totally new and mystifying. The 1950s can be considered the time when medicine of sleep began, or rather the beginnings of an interest in sleep, the first polysomnographic recordings. These beginnings were mainly the domain of psychoanalysts, psychiatrists, and psychologists, and were mainly concerned with dreams. It would take nearly a score of years until other branches of medicine turned to studying them, and then not entirely. My final citation is this work written in 1968.
No i ostatnia z tych cytowanych czy przytaczanych przeze mnie prac to jest praca Rechtschaffena i Kalesa. To jest opublikowane w 68
roku. Their textbook concerned the standards of recording and analysis of sleep. It's a sort of Bible for sleep researchers. Everyone who studies sleep has had to wade through this. It's an old textbook, fully 35 years old, but the data and standards it contains are still actual.
Ale jakby ciągle te dane, te standardy w nim zawarte obowiązują i to było dosyć niezwykłe jak na medycynę.
It was quite uncommon in the field of medicine. Most viewers probably know that every medical school has its own school of thought and usually standardizes certain diseases in its own way. However, we in sleep research were fortunate in that once these standards were published, they began to be used by researchers all around the world. Over the past 30 years, we've collected data from sleep studies performed according to rigorously defined criteria, which has made it much easier to read and interpret the work of others. It's not important whether sleep is studied in Poland, Germany, America, Japan, or even in the former USSR. Every researcher views, describes, and evaluates sleep in the same manner. This work is the most frequently quoted in sleep literature, and to this day, the foundation for sleep research. Now I'd like to show you that sleep research conducted according to these standards, what it looks like in practice. Electrodes are attached to the head, which record the biological activity of the brain, and there are electrodes around the eyes to record eye movements. The reason why it is so that we can catch the movements during waking when a person moves his eyes, and REM sleep when a person also moves his eyes, and muscle tension, which falls during deep sleep and turns off completely during paradoxical sleep. And so we have EEG, EOG, and EMG recordings for the entire period of sleep. This picture shows what a sleep research laboratory looked like until 5 or 6 years ago. One such night produced 560 to 580 meters of paper covered in diligent scribbles. Fortunately, now we have computers, although we also look at sleep on paper. It hasn't changed the difficulty difficulty of the work, we still have to review 1500 to 1600 elements, page by page, in order to be able to describe the sleep. But there is much more order now and less paper. Some medical philosophers even say that a person functions in three separate states of awareness: awake, when the brain and body are both awake; non-REM sleep, when the brain and body are both asleep; and REM sleep, when the body sleeps but the brain works very actively, all alone, freed from the body. It's different brain chemistry, other receptors, other metabolic pathways, and completely different structures, as if we have three separate brains, each working for themselves. I've given some thought as to what is the essential side of human existence, since we are awake, as one of you once wrote, only so that we may satisfy our hunger and sexual drive. Now we have these three recordings, EEG, EOG, and EMG. We can see that this upper recording, the EEG, is scattered. And if we started counting peaks, then here we'd have around 20 per second, while here, for example, only two. These are so-called slow waves. This discovery, made more or less at the end of the 1980s, consisted of linking the number of slow waves with the depth and quality of sleep. I mentioned earlier that in studying sleep, we can evaluate it not only qualitatively, but quantitatively too. That's what we do when we analyze the number of slow waves. The more slow waves, the deeper the sleep, and the more regenerative. The fewer there are, the worse a person sleeps. In REM sleep, we see the muscles completely flaccid. That's obvious. Since the brain is working, the muscles must be flaccid to prevent us from running. There are disorders where this turning off of muscle tension is disturbed. A series of now famous experiments were done in the 1970s and 1980s featuring the famous cats of Jouvet or Morrison, where certain structures in the brainstem and corpus callosum were damaged. Upon beginning REM sleep, the cats would wake suddenly and run around hunting for mice. The researchers determined that they were moving in accordance with the images they were dreaming. We also have an EEG recording, just like in the awake state. Eye movements, that's where the name came from, and totally flaccid muscles. This is REM sleep. Translated and narrated by Roger Domogalski.